Welcome, Bix Weir.
Hey, thank you very much for having me.
Great to have you. And you know, you brought up EOS, Dan Larimer, and Brock Pierce, two key developers, core developers. Cardano, fascinating idea, and also run by an ex-Ethereum developer, one of the early OGs in Ethereum, both unique and promising. Keep an eye on the Solidity language. This has just opened up possibilities, a whole new realm of potential. I mean, relative to Bitcoin, Ethereum is more like a Jeep, a Hummer, and it's solid, but there are a lot of attack vectors because it's a more of a contract open source as opposed to Bitcoin, which is intended as a store of value.
I think Satoshi had a very different idea for Bitcoin as a peer-to-peer cash system. So it was the core developers that moved it away from that into the store of value, which is, you're 100% correct. It is now very few vectors to attack Bitcoin compared to everything else. But it wasn't originally planned that way.
There's even, ironically, a crypto tulip. Create your own version of a tulip, and it's immediately uploaded onto the Ethereum blockchain, and then you have rights to your own specific tulip, okay? It's gimmicky, but this is a game changer. Moving on, we were talking in the pre-show chat about some of the other areas that people might have the wrong initial first impression on the cryptos. And I think you pointed out that this is earlier days than most people realize. Just because there's competition to Bitcoin and Ethereum does not negate their value. In other words, we're probably not going to wake up tomorrow, are we, and find that Bitcoin has collapsed because there were better core developers. It doesn't mean we can't just have an IBM, a Microsoft, and an Apple. You can have many different competitors within a certain space.
Well, I think the argument for the scarcity factor is that there's so many forks of Bitcoin, there's so many other cryptocurrencies, it takes away the value, it takes away the premise that Bitcoin is not a scarce asset because there's all kinds of new things springing up from it. I don't believe that at all. I think there's plenty of room for all types of crypto assets in the world, just like there's room for all types of assets in, like, foreign exchanges, all different types of money, all different types of stocks and bonds and derivatives. And if you really want to make that argument, there can be only one thing that works, and it is Bitcoin, as some of the Bitcoin purists say. I think that is the most ridiculous thing in the world. And it depends where you want to use it and how you want to use it. So a lot of these new altcoins and cryptocurrencies are specifically designed for a specific business case, a use case within a business process. And I think that's where we get into some really cool stuff, because these tokens act more like a means of exchange in the barter system. For all you monetary historians out there, it's always said that, you know, gold is not the perfect money, but it's the best we got. Because barter doesn't work, because a home builder can't trade with a bread baker. Well, if we tokenize homes and we tokenize bread, perhaps it can function even more closely to that barter system than just an overall, here's money and everything has to be transferred into money. So I think that Bitcoin purists were wrong to say it can only be Bitcoin. I think those that say that the cryptos, there's so many of them, the scarcity problem is, you know, scarcity is not solved. I think they're both wrong. I think there's room for all kinds of things going on in the middle, just like there is today with every other asset type.
So I'll start off with AOL. Okay, how does AOL, how does America Online tie in? You know, it helps to be the first one on the block, to have that name recognition, to have that first mover advantage, as they refer to it. And AOL had that. And ironically, even today, I have some close friends, family members, who still embrace AOL, not because it's the best, not because it's the fastest, not frankly because they should be paying for the platform at all, or using it for that matter, but because it's an old pair of pajamas. They started off with over 20 years ago and still use today. And again, Bitcoin, that first mover advantage, widely disseminated in a similar fashion. AOL, of course, they were handing out tens of millions of free CDs to get people hooked, to get them started. Key core developers are taking us in many unique directions.
I think we are quickly, as in probably this summer, moving into a more retail focus for the cryptos. And I think it'll be necessary with the problems in our banking system, especially if we have another 2008 event come the end of this year. But I think that's the key for cryptos coming up, is really get that retail use case out there. Get it so that people can go to their Starbucks and use Litecoin or Dash or Bitcoin or whatever they want based on what they want to choose. And we get it into the retailers, the large retailers like Amazon. There's all kinds of rumors about that.
Amazon, they've actually purchased up the rights. It's something along the lines of Amazon Ethereum and other blockchain names and domains.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. And, I mean, these are in the technology business. They see it coming. You can't deny it anymore. All the deniers are basically now either have an agenda, a reason for denying, or they're just so stuck in their ways that it would be too embarrassing to change their mind. That the crypto universe, the blockchain is coming, the cryptocurrencies are coming, and the main reason that everybody kind of forgets, it's not that, you know, the cryptos are fully built out and so strong and trustworthy.
Using Japan as the test case, if you will, the test bed, this is an entrenched economic system where the needs of the many are watched, I think, much more carefully than in the West. Japan has recently made Bitcoin legal tender. What do they see that our policymakers and legislators don't see? In other words, given that they were the initiators of quantitative easing way back in the 90s, and they saw that that didn't go too well for their economy, and they might be recognizing it's not going too well either for the dominant global economy here, and maybe not so well for their neighbors next door. Perhaps they see a fiat money crisis. And that's why virtually every shop is starting to accept or consider accepting crypto, Bitcoin, and alternative altcoins as legal tender, as a means of exchange, as a means to purchase food, clothing.
I think you're absolutely correct, and we'll see more and more of it. The cryptos are being brought to humanity as a way out of the old system. It will be there. It'll be up and running by the time. But right now, it is so much stronger than it was. You know, if you go back to 2008, right before Bitcoin, the white paper was released, and we had the financial crisis, the only reason the banks got bailed out was because the death and destruction it would have caused if they weren't bailed out. We had no other place to go. Now we do. We do have another place to go. And that is the whole concept behind the cryptocurrencies, behind Bitcoin. And this goes back way long before the release of the Satoshi white paper. I've done quite a bit of work going back to the beginnings of computer programming and who put the software in our hands and who put the hardware in our hands. They were all participants in this white paper, ultimately culminating at the end of 2008. This was based on years worth of work, decades worth of work, hardware and software. We needed the cell phones in our hands to have something like Bitcoin work. And absolutely, the guy who basically put the personal computer in our houses and put the cell phones in our hands was involved with Bitcoin in the early days.
Yeah, the cypherpunks, their roots really go back to, I mean, arguably the late 70s, early 80s.
That's what the Roto Rooter theory is the plan was to destroy the monetary system, because there was an economic paper written in the 1960s called On the Road to the Golden Age. And in that, it was a Nobel Prize winning paper. In that, they said the best way to return to a gold standard is to run the unbacked fiat system as long and hard as possible, soaking up all the benefits, and just crash it because you print too much money.
You know, the Glass-Steagall Act removed, ushering in this period of unrivaled financial derivatives leverage that we hadn't seen since the 1920s. And of course, we all know how that ended. Fast forward to today, and this bubble defies bubble physics. I think even Stephen Hawking would be astounded at the level of growth we've seen since his untimely passing. So you kind of see that as our next Lehman moment, our Bear Stearns, that was really more or less a couple of the tipping points that led us into the 2008-2009 Great Recession. The Great Recession just looms in the back of my mind. Paulson, you know, the former Treasury Secretary, and so many of his colleagues behind the scenes under their breath say, we were minutes, hours away.
We had an we had a Congressman Kanzorski come on C-SPAN and say, we were literally hours from everything ending. Unless we gave the bank $700 billion and free rein to leverage it up to $20 trillion, everybody would have lost every financial asset they owned, and it would have been mass chaos, so we made the decision to bail out the banks. Now, the question today is, will they make that same decision? Have the people learned enough to say no more bailouts, even though it causes mass chaos? I think we have. And I even think, I would go a little deeper, that they set it up so that there won't be in the Dodd-Frank law, they added at the last second that the FDIC has to bail out the derivative holders before they bail out any savings or checking account. So that basically guaranteed no bailout will happen.
I have, I think, two camps of guests here. One group, they say it'll be the same as it's been in the past. They will massage the system. They have so many tricks up their sleeves. They can manipulate the interest rates, which I think is more questionable now. A new level of quantitative easing. That's sort of the old guard economist retort, if you will. Then there's the others who say there's nothing that can be done. It's going to be a complete global reset. They're going to have to lop two or three digits off of the dollar.
The biggest problem is misallocation of money. You lop two or three digits off the dollar, everybody's in the exact same place they were before, except two or three digits is gone. So it would not solve any problem. It wouldn't get rid of the derivatives. Where I think we are is that the people who are really in charge, the people who have the mouse that can click it and destroy the system, have been trying to set up this crypto system so that when they do click that mouse and they do end the banking system, there will be somewhere else to go. And that for a long time was missing.
Wouldn't you say that's really the prime directive of Satoshi Nakamoto's now seminal paper? This was right around that time where, at least according to legend, Satoshi had just suffered some really serious financial losses.
I think Satoshi had in mind, I want to give humanity an alternative, not because I lost money, but because I have seen over the past 100 years that we had had no way out of this system that we put in place in 1913.
I'm sure you remember Friedman's classic comments that we have email, we have the internet, and now all we need is an e-cash way back in 1999. Tim Drape that Bitcoin would hit 10,000 in 2018. There is an invisible hand behind this market, and he alludes to that, and you just did as well. But there is a groundswell of really forward-thinking individuals, many of whom might be MKUltra survivors, I don't know, targeted individuals. But it seems to be a group of people that have rejected the old guard, the previous system, and they want to usher in a more benevolent structure.
I would take it one deeper step and say that that group that controls the price is within the U.S. government. The new $100 bill on the left side is all green, just like the old $100 bill. The right side is full of gold. And it says you have the right to overthrow your government in gold right above the 100. This is absolutely a plan going on to remove the banking cabal, shall we say, from controlling our lives.
The typical person, family today, household, has really less than $500. On average, most reports, something like 75 to 80% of American households report they couldn't put together $1,000 in an emergency other than borrowing it against their credit cards. How does that work out well?
Two concepts. When you say that, you know, the average American can't put together any money, that's absolutely true. But the government takes a big chunk of, so you could put together more money if there were no taxes. The other big component is the debt component. Everybody in the United States is massively in debt. So if you strip away the banks, you're stripping away the debt too. And there won't be this tax thing that we have because all the debt will be gone. So it really can, it won't be smooth. Absolutely no. There will be chaos, there will be death. But it would be a lot worse had the cryptos not come around. But that was always the plan, is to, going back to this 1960s, you know, report called On the Road to the Golden Age, the only way to get back to a gold standard, a sound monetary system at the time, is to destroy the unbacked fiat system. And that's what Greenspan taking away regulation on derivatives was all about, giving the banks enough rope to hang themselves. And that's what they've done, creating this derivative bubble.
Well, how can Bitcoin be relevant at $8,000 or $9,000? How can Ethereum be worth $400 or $500 or $1,000? You know, the retail investors, Bix, only had access to the latter stages of the underwriting process, didn't they? I mean, you had the major houses, the J.P. Morgans, the Goldmans, underwriters gave shares to their most prized whale clients, if you will, in their brokerages, in their investment houses. And those clients, those institutions, they received for pennies on the dollar. You know, we're soaring 100%, 200%, 300% on the opening day, and sometimes continued from there, as Google did. For the first time in history, hasn't this crypto revolution started on Main Street instead of Wall Street, which handed the underwriting reins, if you will, to John and Jill Public?
As far as like the IPO versus ICO, who's allowed to invest, yeah, that was a huge deal. That's why the SEC is trying to crack down on the ICOs now, calling them securities. They want only their people that pay their salaries and, you know, pay their politicians to have first crack at these companies that are being created through the blockchain. They're going to do it in the name of protecting the investor. All it really does is take these great opportunities and gives them back to the, you know, their cronies. And I've been fighting that, but it's, you know, it's like screaming into the wind when you're yelling at the government. At the same time, it's like, yes, this is humanity breaking free, and now they want in. That's the cool thing, is these banksters and hedge funds and mutual funds all want in the cryptos, but they don't know how to get in because it's so illiquid. It's such a tiny market. That's why you're going to see valuations just go through the roof. But also, people have to remember that most cryptocurrencies are not, you're not evaluating a company. The term market cap is kind of misleading. All it means is the amount of tokens or coins circulating times the last price. Doesn't mean someone went out and spent $100 billion on a coin. It could be, you know, one coin for $100 billion, yeah, or it could be a billion coins for $1 or $100, and that would be have the same market cap. So by calling it market cap, it confuses people, but also this isn't ownership in a company for most of these cryptos. What it is the money being used within a certain business environment on the altcoins or with the cryptocurrencies like Litecoin and Bitcoin. It is the money that is replacing the old corrupt money of fiat dollars and fiat yuan, euro, whatever. So all kinds of concepts could be brought up there, but it ultimately is humanity breaking free.
Why don't you tell people a little bit more about Road to Ruta?
YouTube is kind of a new thing for me. I only started about a year and a half ago, and it's just taken off, which is great. But I've been writing, I've had the Road to Ruta website up since 2010. Before that, I was working with Bill Murphy at Le Metropole Cafe and GATA in the early days, going back to 2000 is when I started this fight. So, yeah, on the Road to Ruta website, there's thousands of articles about this stuff and really proving what's going on in my mind and anybody who's taking the time that there is a secret plot going on behind the scenes, and it's good for humanity.
Talk soon.
All right. Take care.